Now joining us on Hot Copy, we have with us today Philippine Ambassador to the United States, Jose Manuel Romualdez. Ambassador Romualdez, good morning or good evening to you, sir.
Yeah, good morning to you, Karen, and good evening to me. Yes, that's right.
All right. So how is it looking over there? Tell me from where you sit.
Well, obviously, as DJ reported, Washington, D.C. is where the tension is, because not necessarily because of the people voting, but because this is, as you know, the center of power. And all the diplomats here are obviously watching very carefully on how this election will turn out. We're very anxious, like many of my colleagues in the diplomatic corps, to find out who's going to be the next president of the United States.
All right. Now, Ambassador, let's talk about essentially, will it matter to the Philippines who wins?
Well, definitely it will. As the report said, this is of a great consequence to the world. As we all know it, there's a lot of tension all over in, of course, Ukraine, the Middle East, and there is some tension in our part of the world. And so this is going to be very crucial for the entire world, of the free world especially. But in our case, I'm quite confident that either of the candidates win, we will be in a good place, in the sense that our relationship continues to be very strong, especially on the defense side. No. This, of course, will follow the economic part of our relationship with the United States. So if we have a strong defense alliance with the United States, we can expect that the economic part of it will also be very strong. And that's where we're confident that either one of the candidates will remain the same for us.
All right. Now, what's interesting about your situation is you've been a Philippine ambassador to the United States for two different administrations, right? Under former President Duterte and under President Marcos Jr. You were ambassador during the time Trump was president, right?
That's correct.
Now, given the fact you've actually had dealings, so to speak, with government the time that Trump was president and the time that Biden and Kamala Harris were in power, can you give us an insight into the difference of how they approach foreign policy and how it affects the Philippines? Let's start when Trump was president. How did the U.S., what was the foreign policy when it came to Asia and the West Philippine Sea?
Well, I think during the time of President Trump, it was clear that the defense establishment here in the United States was very clear about how important it was for a country like the Philippines to be more or less with them in terms of the alliance. Because as we all know, the Philippines plays a major role right now in the South China Sea. And the freedom of navigation is very important because trillions of dollars pass through that area alone. And so the pushback against China's aggressive behavior was pretty much during the time of President Trump. In fact, if you recall, then Secretary of State Mike Pompeo said, we have an ironclad commitment to our mutual defense treaty. They were quite nervous, actually, during that time, because President Duterte on many occasions had said that he was going to abrogate the Visiting Forces Agreement, which is very important for the United States to have that continuing process where we will be exercising with both our armed forces will be exercising together. Now, that created a lot of anxiety, to say the least, on how how that thing would play out in the end. And so the difference is that we were able to manage that whole relationship. And I think the defense establishment during the time of President Trump sort of like gave him the kind of the right advice that that we should continue to have a strong alliance with the Philippines. Obviously, with the Biden administration, we saw that really go up tremendously, especially with President Marcos, who knew that the importance of having an alliance with the United States is important for our interests. And our interests are actually quite aligned.
And you have Kamala Harris visiting the Philippines twice, right?
That's right. That's correct. And President Marcos, to a certain extent, has already had a lot of interaction with the vice president. And I think that They saw each other in Indonesia, and they saw each other in the Philippines, of course, and here in Washington twice when the president came here. So I think that there's no question that there's already what we call a good working relationship between the vice president and President Marcos. But as I said, whoever becomes president, I don't see any problem, really. I have already talked to many of the people around the former president who were our friends during the time when I was here, and now they most likely will be going back to be working with the administration of President Trump. And they assured me that the relationship will be the same.
Okay. And I wanted to ask you, I mean, just on an interesting note, when it comes to President Marcos Jr., I mean, of course, regardless who wins, he's probably going to have a good relationship with Trump as well because of his own social skills and diplomatic skills. But how different would that be considering you have President Marcos Jr., who's essentially been welcomed by the U.S. under the Biden administration? You have the vice president coming to the Philippines, seeing Marcos, right? I mean, how different would that be for President Marcos Jr.?
And I don't see much difference in the sense that President Marcos has been able to, as you know, he was educated in England and here in the United States. So he has no problem really dealing with many of the Western world. President Marcos told me that he actually met former President Trump many years ago when he used to go to New York, especially when his mother, Mrs. Imelda Marcos, was in New York, and there were several events I think where President Marcos was with his mother, and they had a chance to meet then businessman Donald Trump.
All right. Now let's talk about the economy. When former President Donald Trump won the first time, it was Make America Great Again. And I remember his promises, right, Ambassador? It was to bring back manufacturing to the United States, to essentially focus more on U.S.-made goods instead of imports coming from China. And now you have Donald Trump again. Essentially, a part of his campaign was his global tariff plans. How will that affect the Philippines, if it will? I mean, he's talked about tariff plans coming from Mexico and China, but will that affect us, Mr. Ambassador?
Well, to a certain extent, it will. I think that what we're concerned about, really, if President Trump becomes the president again, is that precisely what you said, that he plans to bring American business back into the United States, especially those that are already or are leaving China. Many of those businesses were actually looking into the Philippines and to the other ASEAN countries.
Yes.
Some of them will not matter really. Whatever President Trump, or whatever his policy would be, they have to have presence in the Asian region because it is a growing market. We don't see that. But the point here is that the exports now of the Philippines to the United States has increased tremendously over the past 2 to 3 years.
Biden's administration.
Yes, that's correct. Actually, two countries in Asia have been exporting quite substantially to the United States, the Philippines and Vietnam, which tells you that the supply, which is the supply chain, is important here. And that's why that is what we're gunning for. We're trying to get many of these necessary supply chains that will send out some of these things to some of these exports to the United States, being manufactured or being set up in the Philippines.
Yeah. So, based on what he said in one of his speeches, he said that if he wins, he's going to impose a 60% tax on products coming from China, but a 10 to 20% fee on all other foreign goods. So that includes the Philippines. And will that matter in terms of the supply chain? Are you seeing a more closed U.S. if Trump wins?
I wouldn't want to say completely that there would be a closed U.S. because we live in a global village. The United States will need supplies coming from, especially from the Asian region. So there will be some practical ways of being able to move in that direction. And I think that this is where we will be negotiating, obviously, if there is a Trump administration. Our economic managers, our economic team, we're all ready to get into the picture and to try and negotiate where it will be beneficial for both the United States and the Philippines. Yeah. Like I said, there are some supplies that the Philippines can actually give or export to the United States, which they need. And vice versa, we also have what we need from the United States, and we have other things that we can work with as far as the economy is concerned. So it's really like, well, you could call it transactional, but bottom line is it will have to be good for both. It'll have to be good for both.
And I wanted to ask you, although what's interesting, because during the Trump presidency is former President Rodrigo Duterte wasn't, I would have to say, you can correct me in this, he wasn't as I would say, I want to use the right word, he wasn't as close to the U.S., would you agree, compared to President Marcos Jr. is today. So what I want to ask you is, let's say we have a Trump presidency, are you seeing less support, for example, on the defense side? Let's go back to defense a bit. Did you see more support in terms of the defense side coming from the Biden administration, even in terms of modernizing our troops, the military, right? Did you see that difference? Because you've sat through both, you've witnessed both.
Well, actually, we're much better off now in terms of our relationship with the United States. But let me tell you that in the U.S. Congress, we have now a very strong bipartisan support. In fact, the $500 million modernization fund that they're for the FMF, the foreign military financing that is coming out of the U.S. Congress, was actually authored by a good friend of ours, Senator Hagerty, a Republican from Tennessee, who is very close to President Trump. And he is one of those close economic advisors of President Trump. He understands and knows how important it is to have friends like the Philippines, allies like the Philippines, to be part of the economic sphere of influence of the United States.
Yes. Okay. Let's talk about now immigration. All right. Right now, and you can correct me with this, there are, at least coming from 2022, that's the census I have, there were more than 4.5 million Filipino Americans already in the U.S. That makes up around 17% of the Asian American population, the largest in California, Hawaii, Illinois, Texas, Florida, Nevada, and the New York metropolitan area. There are reports that say the Filipino Americans could be the swing vote in Nevada. Do you agree? Are we that powerful already as a minority group?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I can tell you that, well, your figures are correct. It's 4.3, but officially it's 4.3, but it could go up to 4.5. But I think that in Nevada, it's clear that it is a red state. So we have leaders there that we have dealt with in the past, and they have clearly indicated to me that they will support a Trump presidency. So that definitely goes to show you how important it is that Nevada, which is already a red state, you have Filipino Americans actually being very strong supporters of the former president.
Yeah. And you know what? Maybe because, well, you've been living in the U.S. for so long because of your job, right? I want to ask you this. The world is looking at it and they're thinking, here is a convicted felon. Why is the U.S., why are half of Americans still pro-Trump? I think that's a global question, right? When you read mainstream media, Ambassador, they're saying how dangerous Trump would be to the world and the next generation. This is a man who thinks the climate change is a hoax. And yet he has the support of 50% of Americans. Based on what you've witnessed, what is it, sir?
And you know, if you look at the history of the world, the history of leaders, there will always be leaders that thinks out of the box, or somebody that is sort of like not from mainstream type of politician. And I think...
Like former President Duterte, to be fair.
Well,
he's
you could probably say that. That's true, that he was really not from Manila politics. He was from local politics of Davao. And it caught the attention of many of the majority of the voters. And that's the same thing here. I think that because he was president, he was elected president in 2016, you could see that or give that as an example that Americans are sort of like tired of the same kind of politics that's taking place in Washington, D.C. So they see somebody that doesn't think the way most politicians think. And so they voted him in. And maybe those followers continue to believe in him. And that's really what it is. You will always have that type of like a wake-up call, so to speak, whether a person is a convicted felon or is different from many other politicians or not even a politician, really, because you can just rightly say that Donald Trump is a businessman and a real estate mogul, but here he is. He's actually potentially could become the president of the United States once again.
And I think that's also interesting, just as a comparison here, is, I mean, a lot of the Philippines, our constitution was patterned after the U.S., but then our president in the Philippines can only run one time, that's 6 years. But what's interesting in the U.S. is they can run twice. If they lose, they can run again. So this one, I'm curious personally, is there a limitation? So how many times a president can run? Can you run again?
Well, the maximum here is 8 years. President Trump lost in the last election. Therefore, he can run again for another 4 years, but he cannot run again after that. There's already a petition as far as that's concerned.
Okay, thank you for that. Then exit polls that are coming out, they were interviewing American voters. Questions like, whoever you voted for, what was the main reason? And interestingly, it wasn't immigration, because globally there's a lot of talk on immigration, but it's the economy. It's the economy. So I want to ask you, Ambassador, what is the main issue with the economy for Americans, right? That maybe the world isn't seeing.
Well, I think for Americans, it's really the inflation that has taken place, prices, all of that is adding up to what they feel right now is the reason why they're looking at President Trump, who can change that. That's probably that's one of the main issues against the current administration of President Biden. The prices have gone up tremendously, cost of housing and so forth and so on. So.
Okay. And another issue is immigration. I've seen the town halls and it's still about the wall. It's still about the wall, right? So President Trump, when he was in office, he talked about building the wall, but he was only able to build a small percentage of the wall. And then the Democrats were confronted because they also apparently supported the wall. So I want to ask you, if there's a Trump presidency, what are you seeing in terms of immigration? He has repeatedly said he will conduct the largest deportation in history.
Well, I wouldn't doubt that he will very likely try to do that. But as some of the analysts have said here, it's going to cost a lot of money to be able to track all of these illegal immigrants here in the United States. So, and it's going to take a lot of resources. But there's no doubt that that's something that reverberates very strongly with many Americans, and even Filipino Americans. They are very much against illegal immigration here in the United States. At least with the people that I've talked to, they certainly are very much against all of these people being able to come in, especially in New York City, for instance. You've got quite a number of these illegal immigrants that are now occupying even the hotels there. That
was, I've seen it. Yeah.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. So there you are.
So yeah. No, and another issue is, I didn't know it would take space, but it's good that it did, is the women's rights or the reproductive health issues. When Roe versus Wade was overturned, right, it turned out that it was, it took 14% when exit polls were conducted, that voters voted based on that, right? So there's voting based on the economy, there's voting based on immigration, and 14% was about essentially the reproductive rights of women. I mean, this is very local already, but can you let, I mean, tell me, Ambassador, so far, what you've seen, witnessed when it comes to that part of the election issue?
Well, it's if you look at the statistics, there are more women who are actually for Vice President Harris precisely because of that issue. They want, it reverberates again, the issue that women must be able to decide for themselves what they should do as far as abortion is concerned. They don't want the state to be able to dictate to them. And that is an issue that is different between the Republicans and the Democrats. So you can see that the women very likely will vote or have voted for the vice president.
Okay. Now, before we go, I wanted to ask you this. Well, very quickly, do you think by the end of the week, you would already know who is the new president of the United States?
Well, some of the people
historically speaking.
Yeah. Well, some of the officials that I've talked to said that they're much more, what do you call it? They want to make it quicker and faster. And there are some states that have actually adopted quite a lot of measures to be able to do that, precisely to avoid any suspicion that there was some hanky-panky going on in the elections. But some say, because precisely it's a hotly contested one, it is so evenly divided, that it would probably take a couple of days. I would venture to think that maybe before the end of this week, we will know who would be the next president of the United States.
Yeah, all right. And I was going to say, you have witnessed, I mean, talk about this, as they say, is the most consequential election in U.S. history. But in terms of Philippine history as well, as most Philippine ambassadors to the United States go, you have witnessed, you're talking about spanning major stories in the U.S. and the Philippines. You were already U.S. a Philippine ambassador when Obama was president. Is that correct?
Not yet. I did present my credentials to President Trump. So I was here in 2017. But no, I'm, you know, I'm very thankful and grateful that I've been able to do this for the country, because I think that the relationship, and I believe it very strongly, that our relationship with the United States is an important one. It is something that we must continue to have. And people sometimes they accuse me of being too pro-American or being an envoy, but they don't realize that a country like the United States plays an important role, not only for the Philippines, but into the entire world. And that's the reason why everybody is watching out for who will be the next president of the United States, because it is important that they continue to play the role of being balancing between the free world and the other world that we're speaking of, that we know
of. All right. And I'm hoping that you're already starting to write your book. Don't wait too long, please.
Well, I've already started, and I'm already in a couple chapters, but I can tell you, Karen, it's not easy to write all these things with so many things going on. Sometimes you simply forget. But I take a lot of notes, and I will write my book, but it's not for sale. It's just for people who want to read it. What I think, because I've been around.
You should. I mean, imagine you've had a Trump presidency, a Biden presidency, and now you may have another Trump, or you may have the first woman president of the United States. Imagine you've witnessed two historical pivots of the U.S., a Trump presidency out of the box, and possibly the first woman. That's one. And number two, you've been also ambassador at a time when the relationship of the U.S. with the U.S. was, I mean, pivotal under Duterte and under Marcos Jr. and two different presidents at that and the West Philippine Sea dispute. I mean, you have so much to actually share.
Well, I'd like to share it for sure. But more importantly, I think that I really give credit to the Filipino people for their continuing. And I would say that they know what is right and what is wrong. And that's the reason why we have a very strong support for what we're doing right now as far as our relationship with the United States. 85% or 90% of our people know that we are on the right track by having a strong relationship with the United States vis-a-vis the challenges that we face in the South China Sea. That's what's important.
On that note, thank you so much, Ambassador Jose Manuel Romualdez, for joining me today, sir.
Thank you very much also, Karen. It's always great to see you. Thank you.
Thank you. Same here. Thank you.